Well, good afternoon. Now it's after lunch, so you're all fed up now. That's what you're at. But it's good to have you, and I hope that you enjoyed. Did you enjoy the meal today? Can we show our appreciation to Roxane and Mrs. Hines and to all the ladies and guys that helped? Great team, and this past 2 weeks, Roxane and Mrs. Hines have taken the lion's share of getting the food ready. Mary has taken her share of helping getting things organized, and Pastor Hines and Willis and Brian have been a great help getting things set up for table-wise. Stacy always does a great job with the dessert, and we're always so thankful for that, and so we really do appreciate all that they do and help with this, and it's been going really well. And I know that some of you have come every time, and some of you are just joining for the first time today, and I want to invite you to come back now in 2 weeks' time. Well, what we do, we always take an opportunity after we feed our bellies to feed our soul, and we'll do a couple worship songs, and then we are going to listen to Roxane share today, and we're looking forward to that. And I know she might feel a little bit nervous, but everyone here is cheering her on. We're just so glad that she's going to do it. And so feel free to say amen and shout her through and get up and testify halfway through if you want to. But we're looking forward to that. But let's sing this chorus together as we open up. Very simple chorus, but it's so true. It says, we're together again, just praising the Lord. Together, isn't it been to sit across from the table? It's good to see our brother Brian Petten with us. Brian hasn't been in the church building since July, and that's not because he backslid, but that's because he fell and hurt himself and has been working really hard to get better. And we're really glad to see you this morning, Brian, and glad you could join us yet again. I know it was good for you to be here. If you were able to, would you stand with us as we sing this hymn of the church? It says, oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. And this song says, in response to looking at the wonderful majesty of who God is, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. So we're going to sing this hymn together, and let's worship the Lord and thank God for his many blessings and all that he is and all that he's promised to do. Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Isn't that so good to do today, to worship God for who He is? There was a chorus that was on my mind as I was preparing for this. I'm not sure what Roxane is going to share today, but no doubt it will touch on God's faithfulness and touch on how He's helped us through. And I'm just making a guess because I know that all of us have that testimony. But there's a chorus that came to my mind that maybe someone here today needs to remember. It says, "And God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to His side with love and strength. Today, I believe that with all my heart that God will truly make a way. We're going to sing just one more before Roxane comes, and we'll give her lots of time and liberty to share today. But this song is one that we know quite well in our church, and we sing it all the time. It says, "Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all." I think all of us can say that either we've been in a storm in life or we are in a storm in life. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but there might be a storm waiting ahead of you, a week from now, 2 weeks, a month, a year. But one thing that doesn't change is the fact that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's a chief cornerstone. The scripture says the stone that the builders had rejected, they said, "We don't want this one," He's become the cornerstone of our faith. So let's sing this together. And Christ built. to what you have been doing and have done in Roxane's life. And as she encourages us and shares with us, Lord, we once again confess that no matter the situation we find ourselves in, no matter the setback or the stress or the pain or the questions, we will confess you as the Lord of all things. The scripture says that you hold all things together, and by you all things were created. And so you have dominion and power over everything we face, and we give that to you today. Bless our sister as she comes to encourage us and share with us. And Lord, give her your wisdom and strength as she opens her mouth and speaks for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Everyone except Roxane.
First of all, for people who might not know me, my name is Roxane Roberts. I attend church here in Clarenville. I've been here for about going into 11 years now. I'm going to start with saying this. When you're desperate for something and you're praying for something, never make a deal with God, because you'll find yourself right where I am right now. And I'll touch on that a little bit later. But as I was preparing to share today, the verse that God dropped into my heart is found in John chapter 16, verse 16. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Amen. And in that passage of scripture, it talks about how the disciples were overcome with grief because Jesus was going to be leaving and going back to his Father. But Jesus assured them that, you know, I won't be here physically, but I will leave my peace for you. My peace you will have, and you will see me again. And I think it's so important to remember that in today's world, because no matter where you find yourself, in what walk of life, what stage of life, there's always going to be trouble of some sort. And I think it's very important that we remember that, you know, it's so easy sometimes to be overcome and stressed and burdened. And while it's normal to feel that way and you need to allow yourself to feel those things, it's important that we remind ourselves that we are overcomers in Christ. And, you know, it's dangerous to wallow in those places, because I know, because I've been there, and it just takes you further from God instead of closer to God. It's so many things that, you know, when we face trials and troubles and stuff, it's easy sometimes to look at it and say, why me? But as Mrs. Ines and I was talking earlier this week, why not me? You know, the Bible talks about it rains on the just and the unjust. And just because you follow Jesus don't mean it's going to be, you know, smooth sailing. That's not what it means at all. And I think if we allow God to work in our trials and in those times when we are pressed and we are beaten, you know, it will be for his glory, and he will change it around. And at the end of the day, there will be something to be said of God's goodness and God's grace, always, no matter what. Another scripture that I just want to share with you before I touch a little bit on my story is in Isaiah 43. It says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze." God was addressing Israel and assuring them of his protection, and the same remains for us. We can trust in his plan even when we don't understand it, even when we can't see the very next day ahead of us. We can trust that God is good and that he can use things, like I said, to further his kingdom, to glorify his name, to bring honor to his name. And we are called to stand firm. In Exodus 14 and 14, it says, "Stand firm and God will fight for you." And he's talking about the Israelites crossing the Red Sea. And, you know, it just signifies that no matter what, you just need to be still and God will fight for you. So that's where I'm going to start. And then, well, a lot of you know part of my story. For many of you, you've been here, you were here before me, and you know a lot of my story. But it just starts with, you know, Luke and how that all happened and the struggle we went through. But I'm going to take you back a few years before Luke. Mark and I married in 2003, so we're heading into our 20th year of marriage. And we were living in Ontario at the time. So about a year or so after we were married, we decided we'd try to start a family. And that turned into 6 years. Many doctor's appointments, many failed fertility treatments. And I remember the last attempt, we were in London, Ontario at the University Hospital there. And we had done in vitro. And I remember getting the call, you know, because you'd go home and they said, we'll call. It was so, you know, never the way it should be, right, when you're trying to start a family. They said, we'll call you in 48 hours to let you know if it worked. And when we got the call and said, I'm sorry, it was like I lost something that I had never had, but it was so devastating, and it was so hard to see God in that. But at the same time, God had placed friends in our life that had walked through infertility. They knew what it was. They knew what to say. They knew what not to say, you know, and still a very big part of my heart is always with them. They're still in Ontario, but, you know, we keep in touch and stuff. And, you know, God knew what he was doing when that friendship formed, right? He knew that I would need those people. And it's things like that that I just look back on and once again say, God, you're so good. You're so good. So we went back to the hospital. They said, we want you to come back and talk about further treatments. So we went back and they said, there's one more thing we can do. It will increase the chances of birth defects, you know, because it's obviously it's not natural. And Mark and I looked at each other and we're like, we're done. We're just done, right? And I said, you know what, God, like, I'm done. I just can't do it anymore. And if it's part of your plan for us not to have children, then I need you to make me be okay with that. Because I wasn't. We wanted a family. And I need you to take that longing from me because it was just so heart-wrenching. Every Christmas, every Easter, every event you went to, everyone was leaving with their kids, coming with their kids, and it was just us. So, you know, we made peace with it, and Mark would always joke and say, well, I guess we could get a dog, and I'm like, no, thank you. We have a dog, by the way. And anyways, it was a year later, we were home on holidays, and I was so sick. Like, so sick that anybody who knows me well know that I love my coffee. Well, coffee turned my stomach. And Mark's like, Roxane, you probably just got a bug. Because I wanted to take pregnancy tests right away. And he's like, Roxane's going to ruin our vacation. I don't think you should take a pregnancy test. And I'm like, but I'm really sick. And like, I can't drink coffee. There is something wrong with me. So anyways, there was no talking me out of it. I was taking a pregnancy test. And of course, it was positive. So that was a year later, no medical intervention, no nothing. After doctors looking at us and saying, you will probably never conceive without medical help. So again, God is good. So then we fast forward a couple years. Griffin is almost 2, and I'm pregnant again with Luke. We figured, oh, you know, it could take another 5 or 6 years. No, like in less than 7 months. So here we are going to have 2 kids now under the age of 2. So most of you know that Luke came early. Really no problems with my pregnancy. But at 28 weeks, I went to work one day. I worked my shift. I actually came home in between my shift. I had a couple hours where I didn't have any clients. I wasn't feeling well, so I came home. I laid down. I went back to work. I finished my day. Came home. Mark got off work, and I said, I don't feel well. I said, supper's on the stove. I said, I just have to go to bed. I just don't feel well. And the next morning at 5 o'clock in the morning, Griffin had called out to me, and as soon as I put my feet to the floor, I knew there was something drastically wrong. So I called Mark. He was already left to go to work by this time. And I said, I think I need to go to the hospital. And, you know, Mark, I don't know, he just figured, oh, it'll pass. He's like, well, touch base with me again in a little bit. He was carpooling with a couple guys, so we had to get them to their destination before he could turn around. Well, before Mark got to where he was going, I called him again, and I said, I've got the pastor called. We're on our way to the hospital. So off we went. I called, it was Pastor and Mrs. Primer at the time. Some of you guys would know them. I still to this day don't know how fast they got dressed and got down over Shoal Harbor Hill, but it felt like I just hung up the phone and they were there. And they came in and they just took over. They took care of Griffin. They seen to me. They kept Griffin all day. Again, God is faithful, right? And it stayed that way. The whole time they were here, it stayed that way. They were my go-to grandparents, I would say, because Mom and Dad, you know, are 4 hours away. Mark's parents was a couple hours away. And so we get to the hospital here in Clarenville, and most of you would know the hospital here is not really equipped to, you know, deliver a child that early. There's no pediatric unit here. There's nothing like that. But there was no time to send me to St. John's. You know, one of the nurses suggested, how about we send her to the Janeway? And they're like, there's no time. She will have the baby by the time she gets to Goobies. And they weren't kidding. Like, I got to the hospital at 6. Mark walked in shortly after 7. Luke was here before 8. It was fast. So, you know, all I could think in my mind was, God, like, this baby is just not ready. It's not ready to come into this world, right? And I just can't lose it. I just can't. That was my thought. And so from there to, well, I mean, you know, everything happened. It was so fast. Mark went with Luke. I stayed, you know, where I was to, and they had the whole team there, and they worked with him and got him, you know, hooked up and intubated and all that stuff. And the Janeway team flew in, and when they showed up, they said, you guys have done your job well, and you have done it exactly the way we would have done it, right? And I really believe that God gives those doctors and those nurses wisdom and direction in times like that, because Mark talked to the respiratory specialist that morning, after Luke was gone on, because we had to, you know, go home and get ready and whatever. He said, you're probably used to this. And he said, no. He said, I was so nervous. He said, we don't do this kind of thing here. So, again, God's hands was in it. God was in that room that morning. And, you know, we had almost a 3-month stay at the Janeway, and I'll never forget the first time I looked at Luke in that isolate. And I'm going to stop for a second. And I think sometimes the world looks at our story and Luke, and they're like, how can you say God is good? Right? How can you say God is good? But I can say God is good, because the first prayer that I prayed over that little boy, it wasn't, oh, don't let him have this and don't let him have that. Just don't take him. That was my prayer every day for the 2.5 months that I sat by his bedside, was, please don't take him, Lord. Please don't. Whatever his life is, I'll deal with it, but just don't take him. And God honored that. God honored that prayer. And everything else after that, it's been hard, it's been trying, but God is still good. And the reason God is good is because Luke has surpassed every goal that physiotherapists, you know, occupational therapists, speech therapists, every goal that we have set for Luke, he has met those goals. And a couple years ago when we were in there, I'll never forget, we were in his physio appointment, and he's had the same physiotherapist pretty much the entire time, with the exception of before he got diagnosed with cerebral palsy. Once he got moved to a cerebral palsy clinic, it's been the same physiotherapist. So she knew what he was from the time he was just a year to now. And she looked at me and she said, Roxane, she said, Luke is a question mark. And I just looked at her and she said, I say that because I just don't know what to tell you what he's going to do. She said, because he has surpassed what I ever thought he would be capable of. So if that's not God, then I don't know what is. So when I look at Luke's life, I see the goodness of God above everything. Now, I'm not standing here and saying every day is peachy, because if you were in my house, you'd know it's not. You know, there's hard days. There's days when you question God, and that's normal. But again, I think it's important that we not stay in that place of questioning God and wallowing in what is instead of making something great out of what is. And it's like I was saying to Pastor Mrs. Ines this past week, you know, it's just little things that I look at and I see, like, Luke loves watching online church, okay? Like, I hear church every single day, like 2 and 3 times a day. But what just touches my heart is there is people that's hearing church that will never come and sit probably in this church because they come to my home and they're sat next to Luke and Luke has his iPad and guess what he's listening to? He's listening to church. Right? So I look at that and I'm like, God, you're so good. You're just so good. And you know, when Luke started school, like every milestone is, you know, you worry and you just anticipate what's going to be and if his needs are going to be met, if he's going to have everything he needs. So I prayed for about a year before Luke started kindergarten. I said, God, I said, I can't send my boy to school and not know if he's okay. I can't send him to school and not know if his needs are going to be met. Luke had very little communication skills when he started kindergarten. So I said, I need you to send someone. I need you to send someone that's going to be the right fit. I need it to be someone that when I put that boy on the bus in the morning, I'm not going to worry about if he's cared for. And do you know that Luke had the same student assistant from kindergarten right up till the end of grade 4? And that student assistant is going to St. John's with me in 2 weeks for his block of therapy to be my support person because Mark has to stay with Griffin. So that's how good God is, right? He supplies your needs. And it might not look like what you think it should look like. It might not be the way you would have it be, but it's God's way. And, you know, people say, well, you know, don't you want him to do this? Don't you? Sure I do. I would be ecstatic if some morning when Luke comes for prayer, he walks out of here. Hallelujah, right? But his life needs to glorify God. Is it going to be more glorifying to God for Luke to walk out of here, or is it going to be more glorifying for just little tidbits of miracles to happen along the way because this life is being touched and that life is being touched, you know? So I leave that to God. I'm like, God, you work your miracles in whichever way you see fit and just give me the strength along the way, give me the endurance along the way, and just help me be the mom that he needs, right? And, you know, like I said, it's not always easy. And sure, there's days when you don't know how you're getting to the next day, but God always shows up. He's never too late. He's right on time. And I'm going to end with, I have it on my phone here. It's not a spiritual poem or anything, but I came across it. Of course, I've done a lot of reading on cerebral palsy and types of cerebral palsy and whatnot, and I came across this book again. So many God moments. Mark was working with a lady, and when Luke got his diagnosis of cerebral palsy, shortly after, Mark comes home with this book, and it's cerebral palsy, different classifications of cerebral palsy, like so much information. And I'm going to be brutally honest with you. I felt like taking that book, and I felt like burning that book, okay? It was new to us. We had just got, and I was scared. I was scared to read about what's going to happen in a year from now, what should he be able to do 2 years from now, because Luke's cerebral palsy falls in about the 15th percentile. He's a rare case, and he's a rare child. So I was really scared to open the book, and I'd look at it, and I'd open it, and I'd close it. And this one day, I was like, you know what, Roxane, you really need to start educating yourself, you know, and you need not to be mad about this book. Because I was a little bit upset. Like my first thought was, who does she think she is giving me a book like this when she don't even know me, right? Because she didn't know me, she worked with Mark, that was it. And God spoke to my heart and he's like, you know, Roxane, it's coming from a place of good intentions. This is the only way she knows to help you, right? Because so many people, they don't know what to say, they don't know what to do. And you can't hold that against them because they're not in your shoes. They're not walking your journey, right? So I came across, I read the book for a little bit, and then I got so far into the book, and there was a poem, and it was entitled Welcome to Holland. I'm probably not going to make it through it, but, you know, anyways. It says, when you're going to have a baby, it's like planning a fabulous vacation trip to Italy. You buy a bunch of guidebooks and make your wonderful plans. The Colosseum, the Michelangelo David, the gondolas in Venice. You may learn some handy phrases in Italian. It's all very exciting. After months of eager anticipation, the day finally arrives. You pack your bags and off you go. Several hours later, the plane lands and the stewardess comes in and says, "Welcome to Holland." "Holland," you say. "What do you mean, Holland? I signed up for Italy. I'm supposed to be in Italy. All my life, I've dreamed of going to Italy. But there's been a change in flight plan. I've landed in Holland, and there you must stay. The important thing is that they haven't taken you to a horrible, disgusting, filthy place full of pestilence, famine, and disease. It's just a different place. So you must go out now, and you must buy new guidebooks. You must learn a whole new language, and you will meet a whole new group of people you would have never met. It's just a different place. It's slower paced in Italy, less flashy than Italy, but after you've been there for a while, you'll catch your breath. You'll look around, and you'll begin to notice that Holland has windmills, and Holland has tulips. Holland even has remembrance. But everyone you know is busy coming and going from Italy. And for the rest of your life, you will say, that's where I was supposed to go. That's where I had planned. But, and I want you to hear this, because this is not just about, you know, pregnancy. This is any situation in life. I mean, we all make plans, and we all know that plans never, ever go the way they're supposed to go. It says, if you spend your whole life mourning the fact that you didn't get to Italy, you may never be free to enjoy the very special, very lovely things about Holland. And I think that's very true. Like I said, that can apply to anybody's life here today, right? If you get caught up in the fact that God is not answering your prayers the way you think he should answer them, or God is not showing up the way you think he should show up, then you're going to miss what God has for you, right? And I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that I have learned more since becoming a mom and going through what I went through with the, right from the infertility to now with Luke, with everything. I have grown in God, I am certain, far more than I would have if I didn't have those trials. Doesn't mean it's easy, doesn't mean I'm happy about it every day, but it do mean that God is faithful and God is just and he's good. And if we just trust that and lie in that and know that, you know what, God, I don't know what you're doing here, and as much as it's frustrating and as much as it's hard, I'm just going to let you be God. I'm going to let go and I'm going to let God. So that's my advice to you. No matter where you find yourself in life, no matter what it's about, if there's something you're holding on to, if it's something that you're longing for, just let it go. Submit it to God and let him be the one who works it out the way it needs to be.
Good to have you today. Did you, wasn't that minister to your heart?
Amen.
Oh, really did. So there's a song. Every time I try to make it on my mind, every time I try to stand, start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the way, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I ain't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs a major kind of forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. Perfect soul, I thank God every day. Well, there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the way, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
In the fire, in the fires,
there was Jesus.
Always is and always was. No, I never was alone.
Father, we thank you, Lord. This has been a wonderful day.
Trust in you.
Lord, we've come together, Lord, for fellowship.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we've come together, Lord, for instruction.
Yes.
Lord, we believe, God, that you have been here with us.
Yes, you
are. Lord, that you have walked with us, Lord, and that you walked with Roxane. Lord, in the journey.